It is a great opportunity to talk here. So, in fact, I spent a year in this institute 15 years ago, and after that, coming back is always like returning home. And it's a really nice place. So, I will speak about embedding derived categories of curves into Fanner varieties, and let me mention that this is a work in progress, and it is joined with Anton Fonarev. So let me start with a couple of definitions, which are probably well known, but still for completeness, let me say that. When I will be speaking about derived category, derived category means derived category of coherent shapes on some algebraic variety. I will denote it simply by d of x, but more appropriate notation is db of coh x, and this is defined as the localization of the category of complexes, of bounded complexes of coherent shapes on x with respect to quasi-isomorphisms. So this is one of the central objects of algebraic geometry and homological algebra. Okay, and typically I will assume that X is smooth and projective. So this is the first important thing, and another important thing is the notion of a semi-orthogonal decomposition. So let me remind that a semi-orthogonal decomposition. By the way, I also should say that derived category is triangulated. Which means that it has shift functor and it has an operation of taking a cone of a morphism of objects. And they satisfy a number of axioms. So a semi-orthogonal decomposition of a triangulated category is the following. By definition, it is a collection A1, A2, and so on, AN, of full triangulated subcategories. This means, in particular, that these subcategories are closed undertaking shifts and cones, such that there are two properties which should be satisfied. So the first property is the semi-orthogonality property, which says that there are no homes between objects of these categories for I greater than j. So this is the semi-orthogonality property. And the second property is that for any object of the category, there is a chain of morphisms in the category. Starting from zero and ending at the object we have, such that the cone of a morphism from Ti to Ti minus 1 is contained in the subcategory Ai. So one can say that each object has a filtration with quotients in our subcategories Ai. And the standard notation for a semi-orthogonal decomposition is by using angle brackets. So this is the standard notation. Okay, so maybe let me give several examples. So the first basic example is we can take the projective space, then its derived category has a very simple semi-orthogonal decomposition. It will have n plus 1 components, and each component is equivalent to derived category of K vector spaces. K is the base field. So there are n plus 1 components, and each component is equivalent to derived category of vector spaces, or equivalently to the derived category of sheaves on a point. And to write this more explicitly, one should explain how each of these components is embedded into D of Pn. And in fact, for this, it is enough to specify where the generator, the one-dimensional space, goes to. And one can take, for example, just this sequence of line bundles as the images of K. And this is what is called a full exceptional collection. So in fact, this is an old result by Bain and Soon. OK, so this is the simplest semi-orthogonal decomposition one can find. A bit more complicated result you get for a quadric. So let us take an n-dimensional quadric and assume here that K is algebraically closed, K equals K bar, and characteristic 0. Then one can check that there is also a semi-orthogonal decomposition, which in fact is a bit different in the case of even n and odd n. And it looks like O1 minus n. So again, we start with a collection of line bundles. And then after that, we add what is called the spinner bundle. We have just one spinner bundle when n is odd. And we have two spinner bundles when n is even, s minus, s plus, when n is even. This is, again, quite old result by Kapranov. There is also a more general version of the same result, which is true without these assumptions on the field. So in fact, one can show that there is a semi-orthogonal decomposition in which we have the same line bundles here, but the remaining part is in fact the derived category of the even part of the Clifford algebra of this quadric. So Clifford 0 is the even part of the Clifford algebra. Yeah, I mean, it can be split further sometimes, yeah, but not always. So, and if you want to recover Kapranov's theorem from this, you just know that this even part of the Clifford algebra under these conditions is isomorphic to a matrix algebra or to a product of two matrix algebras. So it is Marita equivalent to a field or to a product of two copies of a field. So this is just a generalization. And in fact, this statement, first of all, it is true for all fields of odd characteristic. So in characteristic 2, I'm not completely sure about that. And second, the same holds for families of quadrics as well. If you have a vibration in quadrics, you can construct a semi-orthogonal decomposition with several copies equivalent to derived category of the base and one category equivalent to derived category of sheaves of modules over Clifford algebras on the base. So this has nice generalizations. OK, so next comes a nice result of Bondel and Orlov about an intersection of two quadrics. So let us take two even-dimensional quadrics. So it will be in, so what is my notation? So Pn minus 1 and n is even. So the projective space is odd dimensional and the quadrics are even dimensional and the intersection is odd dimensional again. Then one can also construct a semi-orthogonal decomposition with several line bundles as components, generating components. Yeah. And the remaining part is the derived category of a hyper-elliptic curve. So when you have an intersection of two quadrics, you can naturally, so C is hyper-elliptic curve, sorry. And this is due to Bondele and Orlov. And the curve is constructed from this data as follows. So if you take two quadrics, you can consider the pencil generated by these two quadrics. And you can look for degenerate quadrics in this pencil. So since we are in Pn minus 1, so the ambient vector space has dimension n, the equation for, I mean, the condition for a quadric to be degenerate is the vanishing of its determinant, which is a degree n polynomial in two variables. So there are n quadrics, n degenerate quadrics in this pencil, and we can consider the double covering of P1, where we think about this P1 is about the pencil of quadrics, which we have branched in this, in the corresponding n points, in n points corresponding to degenerate quadrics in the pencil. Yeah, yeah, you will see it soon. Yeah, yeah indeed, there is a geometrical interpretation which will be very important for the rest of the talk. If you take a smooth quadric in Pn minus 1, so this is a quadric of dimension n minus 2, then there are two families of n minus 2 over two-dimensional linear subspaces in this quadric. And you can consider, so to say, a relative orthogonal Grassmannian of linear subspaces of this dimension for this pencil of quadrics. And then it will have its Stein factorization will give you this double covering. So this is precisely what happens. I'm not sure about characteristic two. So I'm sorry. So let me restrict to even to odd characteristic only for today. Okay. And
zero
is odd, of course. Yeah. Okay. So maybe let me give several more examples of semi-orthogonal decompositions. So. Which will be, I mean, these examples go in series, so and this will be kind of sporadic examples. So first of all, you can look for, I mean, here we know that the varieties for which we considered semi-orthogonal decompositions here were, I mean, all of them were Fano varieties, yeah? So the projective space is a Fano variety, the quadric is a Fano variety, and the intersection of two quadrics, if it is more than one dimensional, it is also a Fano variety. So one can ask what one can say about other Fano varieties, and for example, for Fano threefolds. And it turns out if you look at some Fano threefolds, then you can find derived category of a curve inside. So let me give several examples of this sort. So first of all, one can take what is called Fano threefold of degree 18. So its Picard number is 1, its canonical class generates the Picard group, and its anticanonical degree is 18. And one can check that it has a semi-orthogonal decomposition with two exceptional objects. One is a vector bundle of rank 2, another is a rank is the structure sheaf, and the remaining part is the derived category of a genus to Q of. Also, one can consider fun variety of degree 16, in which case there will be a very similar semi-orthogonal decomposition with vector bundle of rank 3, the structure shift, and derived category of a Q of genus 3. And if you look at Fana threefold of degree 12, then there is a semi-orthogonal decomposition with vector bundle of rank 5, structure shift, and derived category of genus 7. Yeah. Yeah. No, no. It's okay because it goes from odd. I mean, from negative, from a negative number to zero, and when n is 4, this is 1. So if you go from 1 to 0, there is nothing there. So yeah, it's okay. I'm sorry. It's a bit confusing. So probably you should assume that n is greater or equal than 6 here, if you want. Yeah, derived categories of all curves except of P1 are indecomposable. So for P1, we of course have the standard decomposition, and all other curves are indecomposable. Yeah, maybe I can also add briefly that you can also consider an intersection of two odd-dimensional quadrics and ask what will happen then. And the answer is also well known. So in this case, you will have the same line bundles in the beginning part, and the last part of the category will be this time just P1 with n orbifold points on it. So it will be derived category of P1 with n orbifold point on it, but this orbifold curve in fact has a full exceptional collection. So in this case also one can give a very simple description of the derived category. Okay, so you see that there are some results about Fana threefolds, and you can see curves of genus 2, 3, and 7 appearing here. Also, maybe one last example which I would like to give is the following, which is a bit more special, but still. So let us take Grassmannian 3-6. So it lives in P14. And let us intersect it with a linear subspace of codimension 3. So it will be P11. Then one can check that it has a semi-orthogonal decomposition with many exceptional vector bundles, in fact, 9 exceptional vector bundles. And the remaining part will be derived category of a curve of genus 1, of an elliptic curve. So in fact, all these examples to get these semi-orthogonal decompositions, you can use what is called homological projective duality. These are just examples of application of this general thing. Okay, so these are the examples, and now.
In this case, is the correspondence between Fano varieties and curves the bijection?
Not quite. So, in fact, I don't remember the details. In this case, it is more or less a bijection in for 12. In fact, in this case, you don't get hyperelliptic curves, so you get more or less general curves. But for example, in this case, if I remember correctly, if you want to find a threefold corresponding to a given curve, you should also specify some vector bundle on the curve. I don't really remember the details, so yeah, I mean, you need some additional data. There is a morphism from the moduli space of Fano varieties to the moduli space of curves, which has non-trivial fibers in this case. Yeah.
And how do the decompositions vary internally? I mean, like, in moduli?
I mean, you see that If you vary the final variety, then these two components, they are just derived categories of vector spaces. They are rigid, of course. The curve varies, but also the gluing data between these categories also vary. So it's an important issue. In fact, you need this additional vector bundle in this case just to make gluing of the first trivial components to this last component in the picture. Okay, and now let me state a general conjecture, which is due to Bondel, which says that for any smooth projective variety, X, there is a smooth final variety M, and an embedding of D of X into D of M as a semi-orthogonal component, as a component of a semi-orthogonal decomposition. So the point is that, in some sense, geometry of finite varieties is much easier than geometry of, say, varieties of general type or things like that. And if this conjecture is true, if you really can find derived category of any variety in the derived category of appropriate finite variety, this maybe may help with some general questions. And I mean, this looks quite funny in some sense, yeah? Also, as far as I understand, this conjecture has some kind of motivation from mirror symmetry, but I cannot explain this, unfortunately. Okay, so, yeah. So, and in fact, my goal today will be just to prove this conjecture for X being general curve.
But
in fact, the position doesn't matter because there are always there are operations which change order of components in the semi-orthogonal decomposition. There is an action of the braid group, so the precise position is absolutely irrelevant. Yeah. Okay, so of course there is a very natural way, very natural, I wouldn't call this approach, but there are some observations which one can do immediately. So first of all, if we want an embedding, which means a fully faithful functor, then we have Orlov's theorem, which says that any such functor is Fourier Mockai. So Orlov's result says that any fully faithful functor between derived categories of smooth projective varieties is Fourier Mockai. Which means that there should be some object in derived category of the product X times M such that, say, the functor phi is given, it is Fourier Mockai functor phi with kernel E, and it is given by pulling back from X, tensoring with E, and pushing forward to M. So, and in my talk, I will always use, I will always omit the derived functors notations. So this is derived pullback, this is derived push forward, and this is derived tensor product. So by Orlov's result, we know that the functor we want to construct is basically given by an object on the product of X and M. And I mean, of course, by looking at this, it is very natural to try to find M as an appropriate moduli space of some, say, vector bundles on X. Yeah. So a natural idea is to find M as some moduli space of, say, vector bundles on X, and take this object E to be the universal object for this moduli problem. In some sense, I agree, yeah, in some sense, but the problem is that in some sense, if you want to apply it to curves, we know quite a lot about moduli spaces of vector bundles on curves. Yeah, and if the point is that first, then we have to construct this M, and how do you construct it? Of course, after that, you can try to find a moduli space of objects on it, which will give you back the curve. But with this approach, at least you can try to find M as a moduli space of vector bundles or something like this. You will see in a moment that sometimes you can do some small modifications. For example, as we will do for curves, we will take moduli space of vector bundles with fixed determinant, and fixing determinant kills the forms, so it's okay. Yeah. I mean, of course, you shouldn't take this literally. Yeah. So, but this is a kind of natural thing to try. Yeah. So and then if you do it in this way, then there are two issues. So first, M should be Fano variety, because otherwise it is not what we want. And also you should check that the functor is fully faithful. But for this, fortunately, there is a criterion. Again, due to Bondel and Arlov, which says that if you want to check that the functor, this functor is fully faithful, so phi e is fully faithful, if and only if the following holds. So we can take any two points on X. Yeah. Then we can consider Holmes. Maybe it's better to say X from EX1 to EX2. So here, EX1 is the object on M corresponding to the to this point X1. I mean, E is an object on the product. Yeah. So for each point of X, we can restrict E to the fiber of this point, which is M, and E X1 is the corresponding object. And the criterion is just that this X space should be isomorphic to X space between O X1 and O X2, between the structure shapes of the corresponding points, which in fact is can be easily computed. So if it is zero if X1 is distinct from X2, and it is just the exterior algebra of the tangent space to X if X1 equals X2 equals X. Yeah, yeah, yeah. It's enough to check this for closed points. Yeah. So we have this criterion, and so you see that in the end, to prove full faithfulness, you have to be able to compute X spaces between these objects. And here you see the main difficulty. The point is that indeed, if M is defined as the moduli space of objects on X, then we have a good understanding of the restrictions of E to these horizontal fibers. Yeah, for any point of M, we can restrict to this fiber, and then it will be just the vector bundle, one of the vector bundles in our model A problem. And so we have some kind of control over them. But when we restrict to these vertical fibers, we have no control at all yet. So of course, it would be much more reasonable to do the other way around. But I mean, then you have other problems. Yeah, so this is the main problem. We don't have control over these objects, and since the modular space in general will be quite high dimensional and with no explicit construction, so it will be quite hard to compute X spaces between objects. About what? Yes. I forgot to mention that as soon as you know that this functor is fully faithful, it follows that it extends to a semi-orthogonal decomposition. So, and the reason is the following. So, first of all, in this situation, you always have a joint functor. Whenever you have a fully faithful embedding which has an adjoint, it extends to a semi-orthogonal decomposition. It is a simple exercise. You the dual bundle and twist it by the pullback of the canonical class and shift by the dimension. And I mean, depending on whether you want to get left adjoint or right adjoint, you pull back the canonical class from one factor or from another. Yeah, okay. So, the main result today will be the case when X is a curve. And in this case, a natural modular space to consider is the following. So let us fix some line bundle of odd degree on the curve. And let us consider the modular space of rank 2 vector bundles with determinant L. So to kill the differential forms. So this is M. And we have this E, which is the universal vector bundle. And we can do all this stuff. Yeah?
Or do you get rid of the automorphism to have a universal bundle?
No. What do you mean? Yeah, it is fine modular space because I mean when the degree is coprime with the rank, it is a fine modular space. Of course, this universal vector bundle is defined only up to a twist by.
But it's
a
here, it exists even.
It is. No.
It's not. It's
you
not
have to prove that the class in H2GM or whatever vanishes, but it's true in this case.
Yeah, okay.
I mean, the Brouwer, whatever. It's true,
mm-hmm.
But it's not. It has to be true.
Yeah, but I mean, it is well known. Okay. Sorry. Yeah. Okay. So, the problem is in computing these X spaces, these vector bundles on this modular space. And a priori it is hard to do, but it turns out that it is much easier in case when the curve is hyperelliptic. So the main idea is to look first at the hyperelliptic case. So the main idea is to look at the hyperelliptic case. And things simplify in this case because there is a very explicit description for this modular space. In fact, this is an also quite old result by Dizal and Ramanan. Which says the following. So we all already have seen that hyperelliptic curves are related to intersections of two quadrics. Yeah? In fact, any hyperelliptic curve can be corresponds to an intersection like that. So let us take two quadrics corresponding to our given curve. Yeah, basically, one can to do this explicitly. If you know the these branching points, endpoints here, then you take one quadric to be just the diagonal quadric, the sum of xi squares equals to zero, and the second one to be again the diagonal, but with coefficients being coordinates of these branch points. This gives you a pair of quadrics which you want to consider. And then, so let us start with these two quadrics, and let us consider, so they live in the projectivization of vector space V. Dimension of V is n, which is 2g plus 2. And then one can consider the space of all, so all linear subspaces of a given dimension on the intersection of these two quadrics. So let me denote by mk the set of all k dimensional subspaces, so considered as points of Grassmannian kV, such that p of u lies in q1 intersected with q2. This is a subvariety in Grassmannian kV. Then the theorem says that, in fact, mg minus 1 is isomorphic to the moduli space, which we are interested in. And mg, in fact, is isomorphic to peak 0 of the curve. And by the way, so this is not a part of the theorem, but note that m1 is just the intersection of the two quadrics, is precisely the variety which we considered here. Okay, and so now I can state the main theorem. There is no this line bundle here, but for any, I mean, this moduli space is the same for all line bundles of odd degree, just because you can twist by the square root of the ratio to such line bundles. Yeah, I mean, it is not in the picture. So the main theorem is the following. So for each k between 1 and g, there is a natural functor phi k from d of c to d of mk. And in fact, this functor is fully faithful for k at most g minus 1. Yeah, C is the hyperelliptic curve here, yeah. And phi g is just faithful, but not full. And second, these functors are compatible with what we want. Basically, phi g minus 1 is given by this universal object in the sense of theorem of Dessalles-Ramanin. And in fact, phi g is also given by the Poincaré bundle, so by the universal Lane bundle. And phi 1, in fact, is the functor of Bondel and Orlov. So in some sense, this can be seen as an extension of theorem of Bondel and Orlov about derived category of intersection of two quadrics to higher ranks. And for g minus 1, it gives what we want for hyperelliptic curves. Now maybe let me see that there is an immediate corollary from this, which says that Bondel's conjecture is true for general curve. So more precisely, if we take general, not necessary hyperelliptic curve and take the functor given by the universal vector bundle of rank 2 with fixed odd determinant, then it will be fully faithful. And so maybe let me first explain how it follows from this result about hyperelliptic curves, and then I will explain the proof of the hyperelliptic case. So I forgot to mention that this moduli space is known to be Fano. So this is always Fano variety, but of quite big dimension, of dimension 3g minus 3. By the way, maybe I will mention this later. Okay, so let me first explain how theorem implies this corollary. So the argument is the following. So let us consider, for example, some family of curves. So let S be some base scheme and consider a flat family of curves of genus G. Then assume that we have some line bundle for this family, which is odd on fibers. In this case, we can consider the relative version of the same story, and we can construct the functor from derived category of the curve C to of this family of curves to derived category of the relative moduli space of C over S of rank 2 and with determinant given by L. And now the point is that the property of a functor to be fully faithful is open. So if you have a family, and it is important that these functors are S-linear. And when you have a family of functors linear over some base, then the property to be fully faithful is open. And it is very easy to see, just because full faithfulness is equivalent to saying that the composition of the adjoint functor with your original functor is isomorphic to the identity. And since both functors are of Fourier-Mukai type, their composition is also a Fourier-Mukai functor, which is given by the convolution of the corresponding kernels. So let me just for a moment denote by E star the kernel of this left adjoint functor. Then the convolution of these two kernels gives you this composition. So we want to check that it is isomorphic to the Fourier-Mukai functor, which gives the identity, which is given by the structure shift of the diagonal. And in fact, you don't just want to check that there is an isomorphism. To be more precise, there is a canonical morphism, and you want to check that this morphism is an isomorphism. And this morphism is given by the canonical map from this convolution to the structure sheaf of the diagonal. And you want consider all points in S over which this morphism is an isomorphism. And of course, you can just take the cone of this morphism and take its support. And project it to the base of your family, and away of this closed subset, you have a fully faithful functor. So you see that this part of the proof is quite simple. It is just some general nonsense. Okay, so we reduced everything to the case of hyperelliptic curves. But maybe again, before I will go on with this hyperelliptic case, let me mention that, in fact, I'm pretty sure that the same functor should work for arbitrary curves. The only point is that I cannot prove it. I mean, because basically, I can prove it only in the hyperelliptic case, and then by using this deformation argument, you can deduce that the same is true for general curve. But still, I mean, in some sense, hyperelliptic curves are the worst among all curves in many aspects. So if the result is true for any hyperelliptic, then it is natural to believe that it is true for all curves. Okay, so let me go to the proof of the hyperelliptic case. So first, how the functors can be, how these functors are defined. So in fact, the construction is very similar to what Bondel and Orlov do in the paper. So basically, know that our variety MK, by definition, is the intersection of orthogonal Grassmannians of k-dimensional subspaces. Orthogonal Grassmannians means isotropic Grassmannians of k-dimensional subspaces in a vector space V with respect to quadrics in our pencil. So we have the pencil of quadrics. For each point of this pencil, we have quadric, and we can consider this orthogonal Grassmannian. And for example, if we want to construct some vector bundle on MK, we can first construct some vector bundle on the orthogonal Grassmannian and then restrict. So these orthogonal Grassmannians, they are a bit different. So if the quadric is non-degenerate, then this orthogonal Grassmannian is just a homogeneous space of the orthogonal group. So if QP is non-degenerate, then this orthogonal Grassmannian QP of KV is O of V QP homogeneous variety. And for example, it carries a very natural spinner bundle. In fact, two spinner bundles. So it comes with a pair of spinner bundles. Which can be defined as follows. So you can take orthogonal flex k n over 2 qp. Then we have a morphism, the projection to our orthogonal Grassmannian. And we have also a projection to orthogonal Grassmannian n over 2 qp. And this orthogonal Grassmannian of Lagrangian subspaces, as we already noticed, it has two connected components. And we can take the ample generator of the Picard group on each of the components, pull it back here, and then push it forward here. And in this way, we will construct two vector bundles, which in fact have quite high rank. So I will call them S minus and S plus. And the rank is 2 to the power g minus k. Yeah, g minus k. Intersection. Intersection. Yes, I mean, by, yeah, you see, we want the projective space to be contained in Q1 and in the intersection of Q1 and Q2. It means that it is contained in Q1 and it is contained in Q2. So it is intersection. And in the same way, it is contained in any quadric in the pencil. It is intersection. And it is very important. Okay. So this is what you have for non-degenerate quadrics. For degenerate quadrics, the picture is a bit more complicated. But in this case, if you take this orthogonal Grassmannian QP of KV, it is not a homogeneous variety. In fact, it is singular. But there is a natural rational map from this variety to the following homogeneous space. You take orthogonal Grassmannian of K minus 1 dimensional subspaces in the quotient of V mod the vector generating the kernel of this form. So if Vp generates the kernel of our degenerate quadric, then we can consider orthogonal Grassmannian of K minus 1 dimensional subspaces in this quotient space with respect to the induced quadratic form in this quotient space. And this space is already a homogeneous variety, and it also comes this time with one spinner bundle of the same rank, in fact, and defined in a very same way. Again, of rank 2 to the power g minus k. And so you see that we have a family of vector bundles of rank 2 to the power g minus k parameterized by points of our curve. Because once again, our curve is the twofold covering of p1 ramified in the points corresponding to degenerate, degenerate quadrics in our pencil. And for each non-degenerate quadric, we have a pair of vector bundles. And for the points corresponding to degenerate quadrics, we have just one vector bundle. And one can prove that this form a nice family. That, in fact, they give you a vector bundle on the product. So this is a proposition. So there is a vector bundle S on the product C times MK. So maybe I should denote SK such that its restriction to, say, X, such that SX, such that for a point X in C, the restriction of S to the point X is isomorphic to S plus minus if X is not a ramification point, is not a ramification point, or S if it is otherwise. Okay, so and also one can check that this variety, I'm sorry, that this vector bundle is in fact the universal bundle for that modulo when k equals g minus 1. Moreover, for k equal to g minus 1, this is a universal bundle for the modulo problem. Okay, and so because of that, the only thing which remains is to compute act spaces between these vector bundles. So maybe let me give a computation in case when so we reduce to computing X space. I mean, we know that we have to compute these X spaces, yeah. And let me explain how this can be done in case when X1 and X2 are not in the same fiber of C over P1. So let me denote by, say, F the double covering. And let me assume that F of X1 is not equal to f of x2. So the other case, in fact, is more simple. This is the main case, in a sense. So how can we compute this? Basically, note that we have, so let me denote f of x1 by p1 and f of x2 by p2. So we have these 2 points, and we have this, the corresponding 2 orthogonal Grassmannians. Our MK is an intersection of these 2 orthogonal Grassmannians. So orthogonal Grassmannian Q P1 K V, orthogonal Grassmannian Q P2 K V, and both sit in the ambient Grassmannian K V. So we have this picture, I1, I2, J1, J2. And the X space which we want to compute is the X space between the pullback of the spinner bundle from this variety to the pullback of the spinner bundle from this variety. Yeah? So we want to compute X between the pullback. So let me denote just by S. It is S plus or S minus, depending on which point we consider. So we want to compute X spaces between the pullbacks of spinner bundles. And of course, we can use the adjunction to rewrite it as X spaces from S to the push forward of the pullback of this spinner bundle. And also, in fact, this square is a Cartesian square, and it is what is called tor independent, and because of that there is a base change theorem, so we can rewrite it as x from S to so we go by pullback push forward, so we can replace it with push forward and then pullback, so it will be like this. And now we can rewrite it as the cohomology of on our orthogonal Grassmannian of S dual tensored with this thing. And then finally we can push forward everything to Grassmannian and to compute the cohomology on Grassmannian of the tensor product of the push forward of the dual of one spinner bundle with the push forward of the other spinner bundle. So this is what we have to compute. And in fact, also these spinner bundles have a nice property. If you take the dual of the spinner bundle, it will be the same. If you take the dual, say, of S plus, it will be either S plus of minus 1 or S minus of minus 1, depending on the parity of some parameters involved. So basically, what you have to compute in the end is the cohomology of the tensor product of the push forwards of the 2 spinner bundles and twisted by O of minus 1. So everything reduces to the computation of these cohomology groups. And here, to compute this, we use a very nice resolution for the push forward of the spinner bundle to the Grassmannian. So let me just write down the resolution, which is quite funny to finish. So the resolution looks like this. So we take this push forward of the spinner bundle, and it is a there is a nice resolution of length k times k plus 1 over 2. And the terms of this resolution are the following vector bundles. So you take the direct sum over all Young diagrams, which can be embedded into a square of size k by k, such that they are symmetric. And when you have a Young diagram, you can consider the diagonal of your square, and you can count the length of the diagonal which is inside the diagram. I will denote it by L of alpha. And the condition is that the number of boxes in the Young diagram plus the length of the diagonal equals to p. So this is what indexes the terms of the resolution. And here you should take the following tensor product. You take you apply the Schur functor corresponding to this Young diagram alpha to the tautological vector bundle in the Grassmannian, and you tensor it with a spinner representation of the orthogonal group, either S plus or S minus, depending on the length of the diagonal. So there is a very explicit resolution like this. And using this, you easily reduce this computation to computation of cohomology of some tensor products of these vector bundles, which can be done by Borel-Bott-Weil. So, after this resolution, the computation is completely technical. So, okay, I am over time. I will stop here.